Hi, I'm Abhishek Saxena. I'm a co-founding partner of Phoenix Legal, a law firm with offices in Delhi and Mumbai. My practice areas are corporate M&A and projects. In this explainer, we will talk about Taxation Law Amendment Bill 2021, which was passed by Parliament on August 9, 2021. We've divided this explainer into 9 different sections, with each one discussing a different nuance of the issue. The bill seeks to amend Section 9 of the Indian Income Tax Act. Section 9 provides for a deeming fiction whereby any income that is deemed to accrue or arise in India is liable to taxation in India. It is in line with the source-based principle of international taxation, which grants a country to tax any income that accrues through an offshore transaction where the asset is located within the jurisdiction of the taxing country. And in this situation, what it seeks to undo is Section 9A1, whereby I think any income accruing or any income which is deemed to accrue or arise in India through transfer of a capital asset is liable to taxation in India. Background to the amendment is a transaction undertaken between Vodafone International Holding BV, an offshore company, and another company, Hutchison International Limited, involving a purchase by Vodafone through its Cayman-based entity of the business of Hutchison in India, Hutchison SR Limited, a leading mobile telephony company, and now known as Vodafone International. Through the transaction, 67% ownership of the Indian business was transferred from Hutchison to Vodafone. Post the transaction, income tax authorities issued a notice to Vodafone for having failed to deduct tax from the consideration paid by Vodafone to Hutchison, claiming that because the shares that were sold offshore derived their value from a business located in India, the transaction was liable to tax in India, and because Vodafone had failed to deduct tax from it, it was liable to payment of that tax in India. Vodafone went in appeal to the Bombay High Court in 2010. Bombay High Court disagreed with Vodafone and said that if the offshore transaction resulted in a transfer of a business in India, then it was liable to tax in India. Vodafone, being aggrieved by the Bombay High Court judgment, challenged the Bombay High Court decision in Supreme Court. Supreme Court overruled the Bombay High Court transaction, going as far as to say imposing tax on this transaction would amount to capital punishment to capital investment in India. Arising from the conflicting opinions of the Bombay High Court and the Supreme Court, the Indian government thought it fit to clarify the extent and scope of Section 9, and it amended Section 9(1)(1) of the Income Tax Act to include Explanation 4 and 5, whereby it said that any sale of shares of a foreign company, if they led to substantial transfer of assets in India, would be liable to tax in India. And the amendment was made retrospective, going as far as back to 1st April 1962. And it was brought into effect on 28th May 2012. So any offshore transaction done before 28th May 2012, where the substantial asset was located in India and the benefits, income arising from sale of those shares was due from the substantial assets located in India, became liable to tax in India. Post the retrospective amendment, government issued notices to 17 different entities arising from offshore transaction undertaken by these entities, resulting in transfer of substantial assets located in India. Two of these notices were stayed by the relevant high courts, and 4 of these cases were the more prominent ones, being, I think, Cayman, where tax about around 9,000 crores was claimed. Another was WNS Global, and I think another was Vodafone itself, where a tax demand of $47 million, I think, was claimed from the Vodafone group. naturally, the Vodafone group was not pleased about it. They invoked the provisions of a bilateral investment treaty between India and Netherlands and an arbitral tribunal based at The Hague ruled in favor of Vodafone and against the government and directed the government to pay Vodafone compensation for the legal costs incurred by it. Cain Group in 2006 and 7 undertook an intra-group restructuring with regard to the shareholding in its India business, Cain India. And subsequently, it sold its business, its shares in Cain India to Vedanta. Post the transaction, tax authorities issued a notice to Cain Group claiming that because of the retrospective amendment, the transaction was liable to tax in India because it resulted in income to the Cain entity on account of the business transfer having taken place in India. And in order to enforce the tax demand, they attached and sold Cain India shares in Vedanta. They refused to give refunds to Cain India that were due. They also seized dividends and preference shares held by Cain in Vedanta. Cain approached again an international tribunal under the bilateral investment treaty between India and UK in 2015. And in 2020, the international tribunal gave its decision ruling against the Indian government and ruling in favor of Cain. To enforce the award, Cain initiated actions in different countries. Early this year, Cain filed an action in the US courts asking for seizing of assets of Air India, which is the Indian national carrier. It then filed actions before courts in Paris asking for attachment of various centrally located real estate valuing over more than $20 million and was successful in obtaining an order from the Paris courts.